and you. Crown him the Lord of life, his triumph for the grave, provided victory for us all. Lord Jesus, we confess, you died and rose on high. You died eternal life to bring. You rose that death should die.
The Lord has risen.
He has risen indeed.
Paul was converted by Jesus Christ himself, and yet many years later, he wrote this past conversion confession of his faith in Jesus Christ. Please join me in it. But I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. I know that nothing good lives in me, that is in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For what I do is not the good I want to do. No, the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind, and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. What a wretched person I am! Who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. He was delivered over to death for your sins and was raised to life for your justification. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set you free from the law of sin and death. You were buried with Jesus through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, you too may live a new life. If you have been united with him like this in his death, you will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Our renewal of our commitment. This is our devotion. I count myself dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Your word, O Lord, is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. I have taken an oath and now confirm it. I will follow your righteous laws. Your statutes are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. My heart is set on keeping your decrees to the very end. Give me strength, O Lord Jesus Christ, both to want to do and to do that which is pleasing in your sight. Please be seated for our next hymn. Jesus Christ is risen today, either up on the monitors or in the Red Pew hymn book. Jesus Christ is risen today. Hallelujah. Our triumphant holy day. Hallelujah. Who did once upon the cross? Hallelujah. offer her to redeem our loss. Alleluia. Hymns of praise then let us sing. Alleluia. Unto Christ our heavenly King. Alleluia. Who endured the cross and grave. Alleluia. Sinners to redeem and save. Alleluia. But the pains which he endured. Alleluia. Our salvation have procured. Alleluia. Now above the sky he's King. Alleluia. Where the angels ever sing. Alleluia. Sing we to our God above. Alleluia. Praise eternal as his love. Alleluia. Praise him, all you heavenly hosts. Alleluia. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Alleluia. Confidence in the resurrection of the Messiah is not simply a post-resurrection phenomena. As far back as centuries before Christ walked the earth, those ancients were commended for their faith in the one coming and their confidence in his resurrection. Abraham lived around 2050 B.C. He was asked to sacrifice his only son Isaac. In Hebrews 11:19, the Holy Spirit wrote, Abraham reasoned that God could raise the dead. And figuratively speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death. Job lived around 1200 B.C. In Job 19:27, the circumstances of his life drove Job to declare, I am nothing but skin and bones. I have escaped with only the skin of my teeth. But in the same breath, he confessed, oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed with an iron tool on lead or engraved in rock forever. I know that my Redeemer lives and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. David reigned as king over Israel from 1010 to 970 B.C. Inspired by the Holy Spirit in Psalm 16, he wrote about the Messiah, the Holy One to come. I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will live in hope, because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. They believed the Lord shall rise. They believe he shall rise indeed. Hymn 152, the first four verses. I know that my Redeemer lives. What comfort this sweet sentence gives. He lives, who once was dead. He lives, my ever-living head. He lives triumphant from the grave. He lives eternally to save. He lives all glorious in the sky. He lives exalted there on high. He lives to bless me with his love. He lives to plead for me above. He lives my hungry soul to feed. He lives to help in time of need. He lives to grant me rich supply. He lives to guide me with his eye. He lives to comfort me when faint. He lives to hear my soul's complaint. Our gospel lesson is Luke 24, 1 to 12. If you know anything about the history of Jesus Christ while he was walking on this earth during his 3 years of public ministry, then you know the italicized statement that leads this reading. The last thing Jesus' followers expected. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly, two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how Jesus told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered Jesus' words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. The Lord has risen.
He has risen indeed.
Please give your attention to the song, "This Is the Day."
This is the day that the Lord has made. Rejoice, rejoice, and be exceeding glad. This is the day that the Lord has made. Rejoice, rejoice, hallelujah. Christ has conquered death at last, left the tomb that held him fast. Gone the sorrow, gone the night, dawns the morning clear and bright. This is the day that the Lord has made. Rejoice, rejoice, and be exceeding glad. This is the day that the Lord has made. Rejoice, rejoice, hallelujah. Jesus lives who once was dead, crown of glory on his head. Risen is the day that the Lord has made. Rejoice, rejoice, and be exceeding glad. This is the day that the Lord has made. Rejoice, rejoice, alleluia.
Hide is to silence all my fears. Heal is to wipe away my tears. Heal is to calm my troubled heart. Heal is all blessings to impart. Heal is my kind, wise, heavenly friend. He lives and loves me to the end. He lives, and while he lives, I'll sing. He lives my prophet, priest, and king. He lives and grants me daily breath. He lives and I shall conquer death. He lives my mansion to prepare. He lives to bring me safely there. He lives, all glory to his name. He lives, my Jesus, still the same. Oh, the sweet joy this sentence gives. I know that my Redeemer lives. Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Lord, these words have echoed down through the centuries and brought joy and reassurance to so many hearts. And these words are simply this: God's grace, his unconditional and undying love, God's mercy, his forgiveness for all sins, and his peace. That you can know you are at peace with him. All these are a gift from God your Father in heaven, and they belong to each and every one of you through faith in Jesus Christ alone. Amen. The word for this morning's meditation is taken from the Luke account, these verses to focus on. While the women were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered Jesus' words. Please bow your heads with me. Well, Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts now be acceptable in your sight. You are our strength. You are our Redeemer. Amen. Why is it that one of the most popular, secular, iconic images in our day and age that you can find on television and you can see in the movies and is replicated over and over and over again is the image of a zombie, walking dead, you know, automatons, mindless, wandering beasts traveling through the earth, seeking to destroy the living, or at least make them part of the zombie apocalypse. Yeah. The idea behind zombies is that somehow a supernatural power was injected into a dead body, and that dead body came to, well, if you want to describe it that way, as living, alive. But before all of this emphasis on the fictional idea of zombieism as practiced by certain voodoo cults, my generation, I know I'm old, I know, so I'm going to be very careful here. My generation used to think of a person who was walking through life in lockstep without giving any thought to actions or words or impact on others as a zombie. Maybe they were just a listless personality, you know. Or maybe they were always drawn into trouble. But we would call such people zombies. You're a zombie. Wasn't complimentary at all. Now, the good news about what we're going to learn here from this particular section of Scripture today is that everyone born into this world is a type of zombie. What we're going to learn from this lesson today is that a lot of us, all of us from the womb at least, kind of walked around focused on the world. What can I get from the world? Give me the world. Fulfill my desires in the world, you know. Or maybe some of us kind of listlessly feeling that, well, there's no way I'm ever going to achieve life in this world as I want it to be. And the reason for that is that we are born, Paul says this in Ephesians, we're born dead in trespasses and sin. We are basically walking dead through the world. Because King David said, in sin I was conceived. I was born in iniquity. I was born in a sinful estate. And sin leads to death. And death isn't just physical death. It means that gradually, if we focus on our sins and our own sinful desires, we become more and more separated from God. And when we die, that separation continues into eternity. That's how Paul, who was a walking dead man, explained the dead estate of every single human being that walks the face of the earth. We're the walking dead. He himself was among the walking dead, and he tried to kill off those who were alive in Christ. That was part of his focus when he found out that Christ was leading a false ministry creating the impression he was the Messiah, leading people astray by his blasphemies. And Paul then sought to eradicate that blasphemy as it was still being proclaimed by Christians from the face of the earth. But he experienced something on the way to Damascus, on his way to arrest more Christians and throw them in jail. The living Lord Jesus Christ, walking among the dead of this world, as in that case among that dead man's life, stopped him dead in his tracks and told him, "It's a hard thing to fight against me." Now that's a paraphrase. I heard another guy paraphrase it this way: "Your arms are too short to box with God. You might as well stop right here, right now." And he appeared to Paul. And that appearance of the resurrected Christ, of the resurrected Jesus from Nazareth, turned Paul around from being an enemy of the cross and the empty tomb to being its greatest proclaimer of that historic truth the world has ever known. Jesus Christ was also, though, before that time, walking as living Lord among the walking dead. Because, you see, he had told his apostles many times, "I'm going to be handed over to the Gentiles. I'm going to be crucified. I am going to die. On the third day, I will rise again." And it was like that expression we often use when we think someone's not really paying attention to us. It went in one of their ears and straight out the other, because that's not the vision they had in mind for Jesus. So they were still walking dead. They were focused more on their desire to see Imperial Rome crushed and the nation of Israel rise into imperial power once again. And a lot of the people who followed him were still walking dead in their trespasses and sins, because all they wanted from Jesus was more miracles. Do another miracle. Do a miracle for me. Heal me. Heal my daughter. Heal my son. And probably, and you're going to like this one, because, you know, it's getting close to April 15th, and when they were talking about taxes, he said, "Go get me a fish." And they brought him a fish, and he pulled out 2 gold coins from the fish's mouth. And if Jesus were walking in this day and age, and I were Jesus preaching in this church, and I pulled 2 gold coins out of a fish's mouth, you're going, "Taxes, no more. He'll pay them for us. Just go get a bunch of fish and dump them at his feet." And ding, ding, ding. So many ideas about what he came to do were so misconstrued by people who were still dead in their trespasses and sins, still too focused not necessarily on doing all the bad things they could find to do, but wanting a goodness that was focused on their life in this world and not on eternal life with God now and forevermore. And Jesus walked among them, the living Lord, Jehovah in the flesh, walked among them, nonetheless staying focused on his ministry. Staying focused, yes, I will be handed over. Yes, I will be crucified, but yes, I will rise again on the third day. And he did. And then something supernatural took place. Something supernatural. In other words, beyond reason. Something that would be extremely difficult to believe. The women go to the tomb. The stone, and by the way, if you look at it in the Greek, it wasn't just rolled up the hill that it rolled down to cover the entryway. It was literally picked up and moved. And that stone, some people have said, couldn't have been lifted and moved by 10 strong men. And then 2 angels appeared. And the women were frightened. Oh, angels. And then they started saying things that made them think. "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen." And this is the most impressive phrase of all: "As he told you." In other words, it wasn't new news, even though it was great news. They had heard it before. They had heard him say it before. They heard his conviction before. "I will rise again." But it never sunk in until now, at just this moment. Not even seeing his physical body, the words came back to their minds, and they remembered his words. And now they go running to the other apostles, who are still, unfortunately, you know, the walking dead, because they were hiding for fear that they might be arrested, executed, and crucified. And they go to them and they say, this is what we, and I better put it this way, this is what we didn't see his body. This is what we did see, we saw two angels, and this is what we heard with our own ears. He is not here. He has risen. Peter runs to the graveside. The body's gone. And here he demonstrates he's still walking dead. He wonders, what happened? The good news is that the Lord God Almighty, Jesus Christ, is a very patient teacher. Patient God. I mean, he's forgiven all our sins. And even though we know that to be true, and we know all sins are forgiven, and we should be alive in Christ and dead to sin, we still too often do fall into sin. And as often as we might sin, his grace and mercy abounds all the more. But nonetheless, believing that means something supernatural has occurred in you. In you. And you gotta stand back in awe. It should make you go, not what happened then, not wonder about what happened there, but what happened here. I mean, you could imagine your heart to be like that of a tomb when you're a walking dead person, dead in trespasses and sin. Imagine it to be, you know, like a great stone rolled against the doorway of that tomb, and you're ensconced in it, spiritually dead and separated from God. You're a walking dead person. And then Jeremiah said it best. He said, he'll take your heart of stone, and he'll turn it into a heart of flesh. He'll take what is dead and not alive, and he'll make it alive and living. You believe. Therefore, you are walking alive, no longer walking dead. Formerly dead in trespasses and sins, but as Paul said in another place, now alive in Christ Jesus. And that's supernatural, because the person who causes that to happen is identified in Scripture as God the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit and his tool is something you're all familiar with. It's his word, the word of God, the inspired Holy Bible. Those two together, the Holy Spirit and the living and active word of God combined to supernaturally invest in dead people a living spirit. You are alive in Christ, not dead in sin. One man wrote these words. This is what happened to all who believe that Jesus was raised from the dead. God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our sins. We are lifted up by these words. He is not here. He has risen. And even a reception that considers us talking nonsense, the reaction of those who are still walking in this world, not alive in Christ, but still dead to that spiritual reality, when they first hear the news we share, they may reject it. What we know is that something supernatural is possible. Something wonderful can still enter into and bring new life to anyone, to everyone who hears the word of God. I've heard this. Maybe some of you have heard it too, about if you're a believer, about you. Or maybe you've heard it as a general principle of thought in the world today. You Christians, you're indoctrinated. You've heard it so often that you just don't want to even think about anything else. You don't even want to believe anything else. They would accuse you and I, all who believe, of being kind of, you know, zombie-esque, you know? We're not really alive because we're not looking at the world around us. We're not grabbing for all the gusto. We're focused, yes, on enjoying the life God has given us, but reveling even more in the new life he has given us in Jesus Christ. now raised from the dead. And they should see that in us. And they should hear that from us. And I'm one of the worst offenders. I was once accused, back in my high school days, of being too serious. You ever hear that one? Yeah? You're too serious. Because I probably walked around a little bit more like this than this. And I don't want to make a caricature of the joy that we feel in Christ, but I want us to understand that proclamation can be much as much visual as it is verbal. And if it's visual and somebody asks, what's going on? Proclaim. And it doesn't have to be an eloquent, articulate, long proclamation. It can just simply be, he is risen. Jesus Christ is risen, and he is alive and at work in me. And this fills me with a, how did Paul describe it? An indescribable joy. That joy should rise to our features now and then. Even at funerals. Funny thing, my brother and I were talking about memorial services the other day and what Phil plans on doing when his time comes. He would prefer not to have a service at all. But he said if they're going to insist on having me lying in state, then he's going to take a creative thought from a comedian who now his name is somewhat not held in such high esteem, but the joke was funny. Bill Cosby once did a routine about what he was going to do for his memorial service. He was going to record a cassette. A cassette, for those of you who are not as old as I am, is a recording device that you put into. And on the cassette, because he knows how people react, you know what, you go up to somebody who's lying in state and you go, they look better than they ever have before. What? And then he was going to have somebody behind the casket push a button, and the recording would go, hi, I'm Bill. Don't I look like myself? Not this way. But in heaven and in the resurrection, this way, you're not zombies. Not in the truest sense of the word anymore. But in the aftermath of having once been dead in trespasses and sins, isn't it wonderful? Isn't it enlightening? Isn't it enlivening to know, to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God? Yes, crucified for our sins, but now raised from the dead. To believe that is a confession of a supernatural injection of the Holy Spirit's work through the Word in you. But it doesn't turn you into a listless, meandering, downcast soul. It turns you into somebody who goes, oh, let's see if we can get this right now. Happy Easter! The Lord is risen!
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Please rise. Please turn the page to the Confession of Faith. All of these statements are taken from the Bible. And it is what we believe. I believe that Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, that he is the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also came through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. I believe that the body that is sown is perishable, but it will be raised imperishable, that the body sown in dishonor will be raised in glory, that the body sown in weakness will be raised in power, that the body sown a natural body will be raised a spiritual body. I have set my heart on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. My citizenship is in heaven, and I eagerly await a Savior from there. I believe that by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, Jesus will transform my lowly body so that it will be like his glorious body. In this faith I shall stand firm in the Lord, This is most certainly true. Amen. Please be seated for the offering. Also understand this. There are many guests among us here this morning. The members come prepared to support the gospel ministry of this congregation. If you also believe that that gospel ministry is something worth supporting, if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you may place something in the offering plate, but don't feel coerced. God only loves a cheerful giver. Gentlemen. If you're using the pew hymn book, turn to page 126. That will be our prayer for this morning, our general prayer. At the time for special intercessions, we already have these requests before us. Gloria's neighbor and friend, Jeremy's nephew, a young man by the name of Tyler, suffered third-degree burns over 20% of his body. They've done some skin grafting already, but he's still in the hospital. We'll lift him up to the Lord in prayer. As many of you may know already, Esther Rogerson, a senior member of our congregation, fell and broke her hip in four places. And she's at Chandler Regional recovering from a surgical procedure to reconnect those bones. A friend of Joyce and Bob Wyatt, Rodney King, suffering from internal bleeding. Is that still true? Okay. So we'll ask God to provide healing for him also. And then we will raise up to the Lord people we do not know. Maybe some of you do. But the terrible tragedy that occurred in Belgium, Brussels, the devastation that was wreaked, cannot take away from those who died in the Lord the promise of resurrection. Are there any other special requests we should lay before the Lord this morning? If you have one, please stand so I can see you and hear you. Then the prayer on page 126 or also up on the screen. You're responsible for proclaiming in faith the bold-faced sections. I'll read the normal font. This is our prayer. O Lord God, our strength, our song, and our salvation, you fulfilled your promises by the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, from the dead. Thanks be to God, you give us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. In your compassion, you sent Christ, the Good Shepherd, who laid down his life to rescue the lost. Drive out all doubt and gloom that we may delight in your glorious triumph. Lift our eyes heavenward to see him who lives to make intercession for the saints and grant us confidence in the greatness of his power. Keep before us the vision of your redeemed people standing before your throne and singing the song of victory. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive wisdom and power and honor and glory and praise. Make us instruments of your peace as we bring the good news of hope and new life to those around us. Guide us in the use of all that you have entrusted to us, our time, our talents, and our treasures. Risen Lord, live in us that we may live for you. Merciful Lord Jesus, grant healing to the sick and strengthen the faith of the suffering and dying. Assure them of your abiding presence and comfort them with the hope of eternal life. Please bow your heads and listen carefully as they offer these up for us all. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, Holy Spirit, Counselor and Comforter, we confess that our times are in your hands. We are confident that you watch over all our comings and goings. So we know that you know better than we ever could the varying conditions of Tyler, Esther, and Rodney. You know better even than the doctors what is afflicting them and how they may be healed from it by modern medical therapies. Therefore, our first petition is this: give the doctors and nurses attending to their care the knowledge and the wisdom and the tools they need to provide healing for our brother and sisters in Christ. Grant them healing through modern medical procedures and therapies. But, O Father in heaven, as always, recognizing your almighty power, if it is your will, heal them by a miracle of your own doing that would amaze all of the doctors and nurses and the patient as well. But most important of all, keep Tyler and Esther and Rodney in the true and saving faith. Paul once confessed that he can do all things through Christ who gives him strength. It is the risen Lord Jesus Christ we know and believe is by their side even when we are not. May the knowledge of their sins forgiven and heaven open and a resurrection glory coming comfort them as they work through whatever it takes to restore them to full physical well-being. We also pray, dear Father in heaven, Savior Jesus Christ, Counselor, Holy Spirit, that by whatever means are available to you through the word that is shared by the Christians living in Belgium, by the Christians who may go to Belgium, by the Christians who suffered terrible injuries in the explosions that shook Belgium, that Christ is still alive and living and walking among us. Though invisible to our eyes, physically raised from the dead, he has promised never to leave us nor forsake us. He never promised us that life in this world would be a bed of roses. He did promise, as the esteemed Rosa Charan, that he would never leave us or forsake us, nor let anything in this world lead us to forget about God's love for us in Jesus Christ, our Lord. At the same time that we pray gospel comfort for all those who need it, and that those who know it would proclaim it, we ask that the resources of the nation and of the international community would be equal to the needs of helping that city and its citizens recover from those terrible attacks. Find someone in your life who has a need, simple or great, for healing or for Christ. And when I offer up this idea, take them to the Lord in prayer. Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. We continue. Gracious Father, you have restored to us the joy of your salvation with happy hearts. We come before you and say, Alleluia, thanks be to God, amen. Our benediction. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. We shall always give ourselves fully to the work of the Lord, for we know our labor in the Lord is not in vain. The Lord gives strength to you.
The Lord bless you with his peace.
The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. He's risen, he's risen. He's risen, he's risen, Christ Jesus the Lord. He opened this prison, the incarnate word. Break forth, hosts of heaven, in jubilant song, and earth, sea, and mountain, the praises prolong. The foe was triumphant when on Calvary the Lord of creation was nailed to the tree. In Satan's domain did the host shout and jeer. For Jesus was slain, whom the evil ones fear. But short was their triumph, the Savior arose, and death, hell, and Satan, he vanquished his foes. The conquering Lord lifts his banner on high. He lives, yes, he lives, and will nevermore die. Oh, where is your sting, death? We fear you no more. Christ rose, and now open his fair Eden's door. For all our transgressions his blood does atone. Redeemed and forgiven, we now are his own. Then sing your hosannas and raise your glad voice. Proclaim the blessed tidings that all may rejoice. Lord, honor and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who now sits in glory and ever shall reign. I'll say it once again, from the heart. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Bless you for being here this morning. We welcome those who are guests here among us. Those of you who may be visiting, family or friends in the area, we're glad you're here. We're glad you joined us this morning. If you care to, please leave your name your address, your phone number, if you wish, your email address, on the guest book sitting on the book stand as you're leaving. It's on your left, or you can take one of those postcard-sized pieces of information and write on there, hand it to an usher before you leave. We welcome the opportunity to serve anyone and everyone in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we pray that if you're drawn to the cross, that God is blessed, and you don't have a church home of your own, that you would certainly consider making this your home. My task is to make it as comfortable a home for you as possible in the light of God's word. Now, the announcements are there for you to read. Please read them, but also note they're on the website, correct? And our website is on this front page, listed down the side, also the email address for this congregation and its phone number, my phone number, and Chrissy Noble's phone number as well. She's the director of our preschool. You have children of preschool age. We certainly invite you to call her and talk to her about the excellent education and atmosphere our preschool provides. The rest of the schedule is there, but please note briefly, the mite boxes are due. Read through that announcement. Up and coming, the rally for the LWMS, the Lutheran Women's Missionary Society, on the 16th. Game night, also on the 16th here at 6 p.m. Note, the Branches Band is coming here in concert on the 10th during our regular Sunday morning worship service. And all of you are invited here for each and every one of those activities. Now, I know that this is a busy day. There are things probably waiting for you in other places and other locations. We want you all to stay. We have plenty of food. If the seating is taken up in there, you're welcome to sit here in the pews and eat whatever you can find there to eat. There is no threat involved in what I'm about to say. Free food. But even if you only walk through the line and snatch a donut and then exit through that rear door or come back through this hallway, you're doing me a big favor. Because usually there are leftovers. And I work here every day. Now, very seriously, God got you safely here. He will get you safely home to heaven. That's the promise of the resurrection. God be with you all. Introduce yourself. Sorry. I didn't tell you I wasn't going to do that. Thanks for serving.